Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Alamin. Thank God that today we can meet again in the subject of English because it is the English for the history student. So English regarding to the history and history education. Today we are going to listen about the student presentation. Yes, the 9 student will be presenting their topic. I think it is interesting topic, and each student will present in 5 minute maximum. Okay, let's starting our lecturing today by saying together basmalah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Okay, Hannah Agrivia, time is yours in 5 minutes for presentation.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
My name is Hannah Agrivia. I would like to present and explain about the megalithic site in Indonesia. Indonesia has the oldest megalithic site precisely in Cianjur District, West Java Province, which is located at intersection of Cimandiri and Gede Cikondang Fault. This site is called Gunung Padang. Gunung Padang was found by N.G. Krohn in 1914. And in 1979, a resident reported the existence of ancient relics in this site. After 1979, the researchers began to come to research in this area. The research was conducted by the National Archaeological Research Center, and in 1990, it was designated as a cultural heritage. The site has an area of 300 square meters and with height 110 meters. The research team believes that this site is a pyramid. According to Indonesian archaeologists, that this site is around 5,200 years before Christ. It means Gunung Padang is older than Pyramid of Giza in Egypt. But in the other side, according to the geological survey, that this site is around 2,500 until 1,500 or 2,800 years before Christ. The building has consists of 5 terraces. The first terrace has a lot of rock. On the second terrace, the rocks are reduced, and on the third terrace, fourth terrace, fifth terrace have a little rock. This site, this place is like a place of worship, and all the structure of this place consists of 45% iron ore, 41% silica, and 14% clay. These mixtures provide a strong mortar base. This shows evidence of the sophistication, the building technology at the time. In this site are artifacts, and ancient metal, ancient cement, artifacts like Pujang, the Rolling Stone, and the others. Oh yeah, I forget. On this five terrace, have many of antique stone, which is in the other side using man here as a heritage. I think that's it all. Thank you for your attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Oke, okay, thank you very much, Hana Agrivia. Please you
mikro. Waalaikumsalam.
Unmute or silent. Oke, okay, next presentation, Siva Hoerunisa. Siva, are you here or still electrical problem? Oke, okay, I think maybe not attending to the Zoom meeting now. And next presentation is Ripa M. Awaliyah. Ripa, time is yours in 5 minutes, please.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone. Let me introduce myself. My name is Ripa M. Awaliyah. I am from Bandung. In this opportunity, I would like to present about the World Heritage Borobudur Temple. Borobudur is a Buddhist temple located in Borobudur of the Buddhist kingdom, where at the time, Buddhism became the religion embraced by most Indonesian people. Until its existence today, the Borobudur Temple is not only visited by Buddhists in Indonesia. Buddhists around the world also visit the Borobudur Temple. Borobudur Temple was built in 750 until 825. This temple was built during the heyday of the Shailendra dynasty. The founder of Borobudur Temple is King Samaratungga. The process of building the Borobudur Temple is estimated to take more than 75 to 100 years. Borobudur Temple is a World Heritage Site designed by UNESCO in 1991. Borobudur Temple is recognized as the largest temple in the world. It has 1,460 reliefs and 504 stupa. Borobudur Temple has a very interesting shape. Its shape is as a pundit staircase, represent the characteristic of a building dedicated to the worship of ancestral spirits, and its structure is clarified by carvings depicting the Buddhist view of life. At first, the construction of this temple began by leveling the land and compacting it with stones. After that, a pyramid-like system was established. However, the shape was changed again. The next step is to build a square step and then a circular step. After that, there was another change by adding circular steps and widening the foundation step. The last development was carried out as a refinement. In this step, the stairs were changed, the railing was added, and the foot of the temple was widened. Borobudur Temple had been neglected for a long time. It is estimated that this happened because of the eruption of Mount Merapi in 1006, which caused residents around the temple to move to other areas. It was only in 1814 that the Borobudur Temple was rediscovered. At that time, the governor of the British colonial government in Indonesia, Sir Thomas Stamford Raffles, who was visiting Semarang, received a report about a large number of finds of carved stones on a hill that belonged to the area of the Misegoro village, Magelang Residency. The hill, which contains many carved stones, is believed by local residents to be the remains of a temple building called Budur. After receiving the report, Raffles then ordered his assistant Cornelius to conduct research. Cornelius is an experienced person in handling temples in Indonesia. In 1814, Cornelius immediately visited and conducted research at the Borobudur Temple. What Cornelius saw at the time was a hill of a ground with shady trees and thick shrubs, and among the groups of trees, carved stones, loose statue, and even temple stones are still neatly arranged, which are part of a building Cornelius carried out of a massive cleanup by deploying a workforce of no less than 200 people. After that, the Borobudur Temple really looked big as a whole. After Indonesia independence in 1955, the government asked UNESCO for assistance in dealing with the problem of Borobudur Temple. Then in 1960, Borobudur was declared in a state of emergency, and UNESCO was more actively involved in this preservation effort, until finally UNESCO included Borobudur Temple as a World Heritage Site in 1981.
Your time was over. Thank you very much.
I hope I have.
Please you unmute your microphone or silent. Okay, the next presentation is Salma Febriani. Salma, time is yours in 5 minutes, please.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi.
Before I starting, if my voice heard clearly.
Okay, it is clear for you.
Okay.
Go ahead.
My name is Salma Febriani from class 1B. Today my presentation is about Penataran Temple. Temple, or its original name is Pala Temple, is a temple that adheres to the belief of Siwa. So in the past, this temple is called Pala Temple, but now we know as Penataran Temple because it is located in Penataran Village, Lita Regency, East Java. The purpose of the construction of this Penataran Temple is as a mountain temple for worship ceremonies in order to avoid the danger caused by Mount Kelud. This is the grandest and widest temple in East Java. This temple is built in the King of Kings Renga at 1200 AD and finished at the era of Majapahit Kingdom around 1415 AD. So it takes 200 years to build this temple. Now I will explain each part of the Penataran Temple. I want to start from the entrance. The entrance there is guarded by two Dwarapala statues. Local people call it Reko Pentung. The purpose and the function of these statues is to avoid the negative energy from the outside. Next is the Great Bell. Great Bell is entirely made of stone. The wall still innocent and had 4 pieces of stair. The body of the Great Bell building is right by the carvings of dragons. The function of the building by Enchikrom is used to deliberation of the pastor. Next is Pavilion Terrace. The Pavilion Terrace was used as a place to put offerings or to resting place of kings and royal family. On the wall of the Pavilion Terrace, there are reliefs that tell various stories, including the Bubuk Sah and Gagang Aking, Sang Satriawan, and Sri Tanjung. I will tell a story about Bubuk Sah and Gagang Aking. So Bubuk Sah is described as a creature with a large body, likes to eat anything, like to a sincere person, and never sleep. On the other hand, Gagang Aking is thin, like to fast and like to sleep. One day, Lord Shiva transformed into a white tiger who wants to eat them to test the two people. Gagang Aking's response was, "Please don't eat my body, but eat my fat friends." While Bubuk Sah responded with, "Please eat my body." So Bubuk Sah passed the test and he then entered the heaven. So what the lesson that can be learned from this story is that as a human being, we must be sincere in living this life. Next is the Chandra Sangkala Temple. Chandra Sangkala Temple, the people of East Java are more familiar with the name of Brawijaya Temple. On the top of this building, there is relief of Surya Majapahit. This relief is also found in some temples else in East Java. Next is the Dragon Temple. The building of the Dragon Temple is surrounded by dragons and supported by 9 gods. One of his hand holds the genta, which is ceremonial bell. In other hand, it supports the dragon's body. Next is the main temple. The main temple consists 3 terraces arranged. In the first terrace, there are relief of Ramayana story. In the second terrace, there is relief of Karnayana story. And then in the third terrace, there is relief of dragons and winged lion. Lastly is Palah inscription. This inscription is made by King Srenga and found in the courtyard of the Penataran Temple with the year 1197 AD. This inscription tells that Kertajaya is happy with the fact that the four corners of the disaster did not disappear. He then put out his joy with the order to build an inscription written in Linggapala Mbaimputalalu. So that is my presentation today. I hope this information can add in your knowledge. Thank you for your intention. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Salba Febriani. Your presentation is exactly 5 minutes. Good. Next presentation is Tangguh Gangga. Tangguh, time is yours in 5 minutes.
Baik, sir. Assalamualaikum. Apologize is if I have bad English. I will bring about King Jayabaya prediction. Actually, Jayabaya prophecy is in the form of a temple. There are 173 prophecies, but there are some prediction that I took and have happened. Number one, later, if there is a horseless carriage, mean that how many vehicles that can move to carry humans without using horses. There are motor train, but cars or other means of transportation. Number two, then the wood continues in the sky. Now it has heaven earth is a plan. Number three, then woman dressed as man. In this day and age is very rife and not a strange thing woman dressed man or priest. Verse and Prophet Jayabaya prediction. Jayabaya prediction is true. Then many people dead to violate their own oaths, such as the council member when sworn in have sworn on the holy book, but still violate the oath of hot and corruption of money. There is a piece on land of land tax, meaning that today whatever we have to pay tax. Now there are more and more crime and more criminal. Today place of worship it is prayer for people to come, but more and more people who come to the place of meeting. It is seen that the Jayabaya era is getting close, which is mean that the acts of efficiency prediction by Jayabaya are getting closer and also close to the final day than Jayabaya prediction. For the last, I apologize if there was a mistake. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Tangguh. I think you are not Javanese. Man, I think you are Sundanese, okay? Your pronunciation is Sundanese in dialect. Okay, the next presentation is Tiara R. Carmilla. Time is yours, Carmilla.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Hello, my name is Tiara Rivia. I'm here because I want to give presentation about the rise and fall of Majapahit Empire. The rise. Majapahit Empire, the last Indianese kingdom in Indonesia. Based in Eastern Java, the founder of the Majapahit Empire is Raden Wijaya. It was founded in 1292 in East Java. Raden Wijaya was the son-in-law of Kertanegara, the last ruler of the Singhasari Empire. In 1292, Kertanegara was killed by Jayakatwang, allied with Raden Wijaya. In 1294, Raden Wijaya ascended the throne of Kertarajasa, ruler of the new kingdom of Majapahit. The name of Majapahit was taken from a fruit name. That had a bitter taste. Maja is the fruit name, and Pahit means bitter. Raden Wijaya died in 1309, and the golden age of Majapahit Empire under the fourth ruler Hayam Wuruk and his legendary chief minister Gajah Mada, who is famous for his oath, he would refrain not consuming the palapa fruit or spice before the entire Nusantara is united under the reign of Majapahit, and he ultimately realized his oath. The fall of Majapahit, Majapahit Golden Age only lasted 100 years from roughly 1294 to 1389. Because in 1389, Hayam Wuruk died without a clear heir, and his son swore over the throne. Civil wars dominated the rest of Majapahit and undermined royal authority. In 1478, the Map and Majapahit clashed over authority of Java, and the Map triumphed. One of the other causes of the fall of the Majapahit Empire was divided by war of succession in 1401, and weakened by internal dissension, it could not stop the rising power of Sultan of Malacca. And Majapahit continued to disintegrate and finally collapsed in 1478 and was replaced by the Islamic kingdoms. Around the same time, the Portuguese and Ming empires extend their influence into Indonesia. The Mang Sultans claim that only by conversion to Islam and adopting mainland custom cult, they saved Java from Portugal and China, and they conquered the unpopular and exhausted Majapahit. I think that's all about my presentation. So end of my presentation, I would say thank you for all your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Tiara R. Carmilla. Your presentation is effectively. I think just in 3 minutes, I think it is enough. Good idea. The next presentation is Aulia Ramadhani. Aulia, time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Shor. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Let me introduce myself. My name is Aulia Ramadhani, and I am from Class A Historical Education. I would like to thank you for giving me the opportunity to brief the press and my paper. The title I took was The History of the Sumedang Larang Kingdom. Later in this paper will contain about how the history of the Sumedang Larang Kingdom. The Sumedang Larang Kingdom is one of the Islamic style kingdom founded by Prabhu Guru Ajiputi, who came from the Hindu style Sunda Galuh Kingdom. This kingdom is estimated to be centered in Tatar Pasundan, precisely around Sumedang Regency West Java. The Sumedang Larang Kingdom was founded in the 8th century. At first, this kingdom was called the Tembong Agung Kingdom. However, during the time of his son, namely Prabhu Taji Malela, the kingdom name changed to Himbarbuana and then changed again to Sumedang Larang. In 1578, on Friday, April 22, at the Kutamaya Vale, Sumedang, Prince Santri received for Kanda Galante led by Sang Hyang Hawu or Jaya Prakosa. Batara Dipati Wiradijaya, Sang Yang Kondang Hapa, and Batara Pancarbuana Terong Peot, brau pajajaran heirlooms that is Ginokasi Crown and Paragon Mates to be handed over the rules of Sumedang Larang. And at that time, Prince Angkawijaya or Prince Kusumadinata was crowned King of the Sumedang Larang with the title Prabhu Besan Ulun. As Nalendra, the successor of the Sunda Kingdom and inherited for the former territory of Pajajaran. This coronation became the steering point for development of Sumedang Regency as a government that has full authority. Therefore, April 22 is set as the anniversary of Sumedang Larang. Sumedang City. My purpose for bringing out this topic is because, to be honest, I also have very little knowledge about the Sumedang Larang Kingdom. From junior to senior high school, only discuss about national history. So finally, I decide to take this topic to introduce it to the future readers, and I personally know that in Sumedang there was once Sumedang Larang Kingdom, which was the founder of the Sumedang Regency. I think that's enough from me. Thank you for your great attention. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Aulia Ramadhani. Your presentation also just 3 minutes. I think it is effectively in managing the time. Good idea. Next is presentation from Mega Prativi. Mega, time is yours.
Yes, sir. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mega Pratiwi. In this afternoon, I will present to you all about Giyanti Agreement or Perjanjian Giyanti. So, let me present from the definition first. Giyanti Agreement is an agreement that contains the expansion or division of the Surakarta Kasunanan Palace or the Islamic Mataram Kingdom. This Giyanti Agreement is a solution or favor for family conflict that are fighting for the throne of power. Held on February 13, 1755, and took place in the village of Giyanti. Raden Mas Said, who opposed Susuhanan Pakubono II, made Prince Mangkubumi also take part in waiting in heritage rights as well. Prince Mangkubumi is the younger brother of Susuhanan Pakubono II. Raden Mas Said is one of the nephew of Pakubono II and Prince Mangkubumi. Raden Mas Said wanted the right that so have been owned by his father before, while Prince Mangkubumi wanted his right is the younger brother of King Pakubono II. The background of the agreement was the procession of inheritance right carried out by Raden Mas Said and Prince Mangkunegara. They want justice and the throne of the Islamic Mataram Kingdom. The main reason of the rebellion was that Raden Mas Said's father, Prince Arya Mangkunegaran, was the eldest son of Amangkurapor. Therefore, the Sultan have become king of Mataram, replacing Amangkurapor. However, because Arya Amangkurat often opposed the VOC policy, which eventually resulted in being exiled to Sri Lanka until he did. In the end, the VOC accepted the throne of Prince Prabuyana as the next ruler of Mataram with the title Pakubono II. With this part, Raden Mas Said justified by asking for this right in the Mataram Kingdom, but this did not go easily. It turned into a war between brothers. On February 13, 1055, in the village of Giyanti, the VOC meet with Prince Mangkubumi. Here the VOC acts as an initiator and a mediator to make an agreement called the Giyanti Agreement. This agreement is the end of the dispute and contains something in accordance with wishes of Prince Mangkubumi and Raden Mas Said. So the content of the Giyanti Agreement include: number one, Prince Mangkubumi get half of the Mataram area; number two, recognize Sultan Hamengkubuwono I with hereditary right; number three, efforts are made for cooperation between the VOC and the people, the of Sultan Yogyakarta, the regents, and the coast palace before being approved VOC. Number four, region in favor of VOCs in the war entitled to be forgiven Sultan. Number five, Sultan is not a title, so Sumaduran is lying in the coastal areas of the VOC, but the VOC will replace 10,000 real or year. In the last, number six, Sultan will approve assistance to the VOC at any time if he needs. That's all my presentation today. I really appreciate having had this opportunity to share my with ID. Thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Mega Pratiwi. Your presentation was effectively in limited time, 5 minutes. And the last presentation is Eva Rahman. Eva, time is yours in 5 minutes, please.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Let me introduce myself. I'm Eva Napuna Rahman. I'm from class 1B. I will present about one on the relics of Kingsley Wangi, namely Mount Kasur. Mount Kasur is one of the mountain with a story that practically identically to the mountain story. Why is that? Because several fresh relic were discovered on the Mathers Mountain. And why is called Mount Kasur? Because there is a Mathers shaped rock and the peak. This mountain include in the study since various finds were discovered there. And why is not as large as Mount Padang? It has its own distinctiveness. It's claimed that there is an ancient tomb at its peak, which is thought to be the tomb of the Cianjur Kingdom founder. There is a stone that is thought to be the footprints of Cianjur's first patih. Located on the border of Gadog and Cianjur villages in Pacet district, Cianjur Regency, West Java, is around 12.5 hectares in size. The grave of Eyang Jayapaksi, who is thought to be a descendant of the Banten Kingdom, is a favorite destination among the location. Enough presentation from me, sir. Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Thank you very much, Eva Rahman. Your presentation, I think, just 2 minutes. I think it is enough. Good idea. Well, ladies and gentlemen, my student, starting from now, I think. Student who not presenting today, please you make the brief comment starting from now for the WhatsApp group because the time is limited. I think so that your time is effectively. Please starting from now, you make the brief comment and please sending in the WhatsApp group. Okay. Okay. I think we have listened about the student presentation, and now Budiani and me maybe will make the brief comment also. Ibu Diani, are you still attending here? You please make the brief comment maybe to all student presentation.
Thank you very much, Bapak Suwirta. May I first to give the comments?
Okay.
Is it okay? Okay, thank you for the presentations for all the presenters today, but unfortunately one of the presenter hasn't come. maybe I don't know, but it could be arranged for another times. But I mean this, I have some notes regarding your presentation here because I haven't know you yet, so I also have some notes about your presentation here. So most of you, I see that you still stick to the notes. So when you elaborate the material or you elaborate the how you tell the story, you are still stick to the notes. So it depends. So the dependency on the notes is still, it's still very, so I think this is what you have to do. Learn more and then read more and then practicing your pronunciations because it somehow could help you in terms of your presentation could be presenting very well. So I have some notes here, especially for Hannah. My comments is I really appreciate about your effort, Hannah, and I can see that you learned the material very well. So you can also compare the material. You can also compare the research between the archaeological and then the geological proper. So I think it's a good job, but you need to more practice more. And then that's it, no questions. Because maybe for the presenter number two is absent. So for the presenter number three, Rifa, from my point of view, you still stick to the notes. So in other times in the future, you can practicing more about your self-esteem regarding your style on presenting the material. So it's better for you to remember the point by point, and then elaborate by your own words. So have you ever noticed I want to ask about, have you ever noticed what are the relief display about? So maybe you can search. Maybe I don't need the answer now, but in the future, maybe you can research about that, about what kind of relief tell about, or is there any kind of meanings about the relief itself, the relief that carved in the stone in Borobudur Temple. So you can search more about that in the future. So next, for Salma, I have comments about your presentation here, that your articulation was clear from my point of view. So it's a good articulation. So I want to know about how is the presentation about that place right now? Is it preserved well? I do appreciate about Salma presentation today. So maybe for the next presenters, Tangguh. Okay, this is about the predictions of, this is about the Jayabaya predictions. Maybe the diction is not a prediction, but instead of prophecy. So Jayabaya prophecy, not the predictions. In English is have fairy about the dictions itself. There are kinds of language or dictions. So in Bahasa is pilihan kata, diction is pilihan kata. So if you are going to tell about Jayabaya predictions, you may say that it is Jayabaya prophecy. Maybe it's some suggestions, yeah. So for Tangguh, practice more often, yeah. Practice more often, practice your articulation, your pronunciation. And to be honest, I myself is very effort to learn English. So it's been 10 years, more than 10 years, ya Pak, ya, to learn English. Gitu. So I kind of reluctant on using my English. So I am very glad that I could join the class with Bapak Suwirta. So for the next presenter is Tiara, the sixth presenter. Okay, my suggestion that you shouldn't stick to the note. It's better for you to narrate by your own words. So you can tell the story with flexibility without stick to the note. So I think that is more, it's more about practice again. Then again, it's more about practice. So for Aulia, I see that you still stick to the notes as well. So, but I see that the Sumedang Kingdom, I see that you want to raise up the virtue about the kingdom itself. So I really appreciate about your presentation today. And then for Mega, practice more. So you shouldn't depend on your notes. So mostly students still stick to the notes, but that's okay. It's I think it's just a beginning. So from now on, you already learned that you shouldn't stick to the note, but it's better for you to deliver your thought, your ideas by your own words. So please, Mega, practice more often. So what is the lesson learned is that you have to be still that you still have to be practice more and more. So for Eva, the last one, okay, Eva, you should practice more regarding your pronunciations. Okay, yeah, most of all it's about practicing order, and before you present your topic, make sure that you already learn, you already open all the journals and the books, so when you have to present your topic, you already have equipped with all the material, and it can make your more self-esteem higher, even higher than before. Okay, Bapak, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Bu Diani. Then, my student, I think what Ibu Diani was talking about is very critical, very important. So please, you ensure about the what Ibu Diani consider, Ibu Diani suggestion, and so I think it is very important. So me and Ibu Diani want to know about your presentation, whether you are just reading something or talking something. I think speaking, talking something, I think it's very important to show that you are mastery in your content, in your presentation, okay? Okay, I would like to make the brief comment also to each presenter, not only brief comment. Maybe I would like to ask something to you. Okay, please you answer my question, okay? Firstly, Hana Agrivia. Okay, Hana, similar with suggestion from Ibu Diani. My question is, what have been you reading the standard book or article in the journal related to the what is Padang Megalithical site? Hana Agrivia, please answer my question.
Could you repeat it? I can catch.
Okay, I think it's very important for student. Firstly, reading the standard book. Standard book as the main resources, and also maybe article in the journal. Just one, in order you understand about your topic, okay? It is my question. Secondly, how you can sure and understand that, for example, the age of Padang Megalithic site is 2500 before Christ. How do you know that you can coming to the conclusion that the Padang Gunung Padang Megalithic site was 2500 before Christ?
Oh, I read the journal about this, about my topic, and the journal tell about that, but not
what the title
is
because why it is so is very important in order that you are, should be different between the dongeng and the history, right?
Yes, the title Gunung Padang Cianjur Pelestarian Situs Megalitikum Terbesar Warisan Dunia.
Okay, who the authors? Yeah. Who the authors?
What is the authors, sir?
I think you are. What is your sources? Comes from internet, from Facebook?
Oh, yeah, from internet.
No, yeah. I think it should be from journal. From journal. The author should be clear. The name of journal should be clear. And so, particularly book.
The author
and that
is,
book is very important.
The author is Sutarman, Haryono Edi Hermawan, and Cecep Hilman.
Do you know who are them? They are the archaeologists, a geologist, or the common people?
It's from STKIP Sera, Tangerang, Banten, STIEISM, and STAI, Garut, Jawa Barat.
They are economic. They are no expert in the, in the geology, in the archaeology. Okay, so you must read the standard book. That is, it is very important. Okay, I suggest you, and Bu Diani also suggest you, particularly in the MEC, the poor people, please use the list of sources at least 10 sources based on the standard book, the authoritative book, and article in the journal, right?
Yeah, sir, and I have read too on website UI. UI website.
No, I suggest you standard book and authoritative article in the journal, okay?
Thank you, sir.
Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, okay, next. Reva M. Avalia, I think it is also similar. What have been you reading the standard book or article in the journal related to the Borobudur Temple? Answer my question. Reva M. Avalia, what standard book related to the Borobudur Temple? Where is Reva Avalia?
Yes.
Do you understand my question?
Can you repeat the question?
My question is quiz. Okay. Secondly, how are you sure that Borobudur Temple within 9th century? What sources do you know? So because of that, what kind of book, standard book, you read that Borobudur Temple is put in 9th or 8th century? Reva, do you understand my question? No, sir. Because according to Bune, you are just reading about your topic. Maybe you not yet understand about your topic, okay? Okay. It's never mind. Please, you make the poor people you should understand about the Borobudur Temple, right? Next, Salma Febriani, I think it is similar. Penataran temple, your presentation is good, I think, but similar with other presenter. What kind of book? What the standard book you read about the penataran temple, Salma?
No, I don't really read any. A primer source, I just read from website of eastjava.com.
Okay, please you searching in the academic journal and also the book related to the maybe Hindu Buddha period in Jawa history, right? Please you searching in the Google and so on. Last question, do you know what the meaning of penataran?
Penataran is, it's actually just the place to find that temple. Okay. The original name is Pala Temple, but because that temple is located in Penataran Village, so the name is Penataran Temple.
Oh, is it just the name of village, right?
Right.
Because if you as Javanese, Penataran is the special meaning, like Penataran P4, right?
I think it's upgrading temple. I don't know.
Please, you said maybe from the article in the journal and so on, okay? For your poor people, when you make the poor people, please not only searching the many books, but also a lot of article in the journal, and also meaning of penataran should be explaining, okay?
Yes.
Okay, next, Tangguh Agangga, your prediction, I think. Ibu Diani is exactly right. Prophecy, it is the relevant for the what is Jayabaya King or the King Jayabaya prophecy. Prophecy is ramalan, right? Prediction is prediksi. Prediksi exactly, but ramalan is maybe right, maybe no, okay, maybe not. Okay, similar. What kind of standard book you read about the? King Jayabaya prophecy, Tangguh.
I reading in website education.
It is similar. Website is still, I think, maybe third sources or second sources, not the primary sources. Okay, so please you searching about the books or article in the journal. Okay, not comes from website is unclear resources. Okay, should be there's many study about the Kediri Kingdom, Jayabaya King, and so on and so forth. You should searching about the authoritative book, standard book, and also article in the journal. Okay, and it is my question. Are you Javanese or Sundanese, Tango?
Sundanese.
Ah, Sundanese. You didn't speak the Javanese, okay? So my question, what the kind of Jayabaya prophecy in the time of Japanese occupation in 1942 to 1945? What kind of Jayabaya prophecy in that time?
I not understand, sir.
Okay. Please, following Ibu Diani suggestion, yeah, it should be more practice, reading in English, practice English, and so on and so forth. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Okay. Okay, next, Tiara R. Carmilla. Related to the Majapahit Empire, Carmilla, what kind of book, standard book, you have read?
I just searching of some journals, sir.
Okay, what the title, what the authors, who the authors?
Journals dari from Universitas Gajah Mada.
Gajah Mada Institution. I need you inform us about the authors in order we can know whether the author is historian, geologist, anthropologist, so on and so forth. Who the authors?
The author is Haryono.
Haryono, I think it's history education, not expert in. So please you read about the Majapahit Kingdom. There is the graph about the what is Slamet Muljana books. I think it is about the Majapahit Kingdom, Majapahit Empire, okay? So I suggest you read more books, standard book related to Majapahit Empire. Okay, the last question, critical question. Why in Bandung, particularly in West Java, generally, they ask no street the name Gajah Mada and Hayam Wuruk? You understand? Why in Bandung, particularly in West Java, commonly, there is no name of Gajah Mada and Hayam Wuruk Street? I don't know, sir.
I don't know.
Okay. According to Budiani, please, you read many books, a lot of article in the journal, so you understand about the Majapahit Empire, ya. Kunaon atuh teu aya nami Jalan Gajah Mada sareng Hayam Wuruk di Bandung, di Jawa Barat. Aduh, kapa dengar tos abdi ge. Okay, next, Aulia Ramadhani. Similar, what kind of standard book or article in the journal related to Sumedang Larang?
I think similar from other presentation, I read from journal.
What the authors, who the authors, what the title?
The title, Sejarah Kerajaan Sumedang Larang. The author is Istri Snawati S. from Kemendikbud.
Okay, the book, maybe?
From the book, I think it's hard to... Sorry, sir.
Okay, please you search in what is related to the standard book or the authoritative book, okay? Okay, the last question. Aulia, why the Sumedang Larang Kingdom in political orientation toward the Mataram Kingdom in Central Java comparing to the Banten Kingdom in West Java? Why the political orientation of Sumedang Kingdom to Mataram, not to Banten Kingdom?
I know the answer, but I can speak in English. Sir,
no, because you don't read the book, standard book. Because of that, you cannot answer the question. Okay.
I have the answer, but I can speak in English.
No, you should speak in English, not in Sundanese or in the Bahasa Indonesia. It is the English subject, right? Okay.
That was when there is an event that Sumedang and Cirebon.
Okay, please you elaborate my question in your full paper, right? I think it is very important to understand why the Sumedang Larang finally in political orientation toward the Mataram Kingdom in Central Jawa comparing to the Banten Kingdom in West Java. Okay, I think it is very critical question for you. Okay, next Mega Pratiwi, Mila, what kind of standard book you have read?
I read on the web, sir.
I think you should read about the Merle Calvin Rickler. His dissertation is Giante Agreement. Okay, Merle Calvin Rickler. Rickler, that's popular with the modern Indonesian history. I think you should also read about this book. It's very important to understand about the Giante Agreement. Okay, the last question: what is different title of king between the Yogyakarta Sultanate and Surakarta Sultanate, and what the meaning? Mega? Because you didn't reading the book. Okay, I think. Okay, it's please you read the Rickleff book, Giante Agreement, and modern Indonesian history. I think it is very important for you, including also the article and the journal, right? The last, Eva Rahman. Eva, similar, what the kind of standard book, authoritative book you have read related to the Siliwangi King, the King Siliwangi?
Dari Pajajaran. From Pajajaran.
You don't understand my question, okay? Okay, the last question. What the meaning? What the really meaning this motto? Esa hilang, dua terbilang. What does it mean? Eva, esa hilang, dua terbilang. What does it mean? What the meaning? Oh, esa hilang and dua terbilang. Okay, you cannot answer my question. Okay, okay, ladies and gentlemen, my student, I think it is important for you, based on Ibu Diani suggestion, Ibu Diani what is recommendation? Please read many books and also article in the journal, because this is English for history student, English for history and history education. So you not only master or fluency in speaking, but also should be mastery in the content of history. I think it's very important. Okay, so please ensure that your topic, you are understand about your topic. Because of that, when you match the poor people, please ensure also in the list of reference at least 10 sources should be used in your poor people. Okay, there's the two pages, but I want to know also about your reference, whether your reference is just common sense or according to not expert opinion. I think it is very critical for you. If you talk about something, there are many experts. For example, if you want to talk about the history of newspaper in the time of revolution, you should refer my books. If you talk about the peasant revolt in Banten, you should refer of Sartono Kartodijos book. If you talk about the Giante Agreement, you should refer to the Rickleff's book. I think as student of history, should know about the standard book, authoritative book, okay? Okay, I think it is the what is first lesson for you as the student of history, in order could identify many books related to the your topic, standard book or the authoritative article in the academic journal. I think it is enough my lecturing today. Let's ending my lecturing today by saying together Hamdalah. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah.
Thank you very much. We will meet again in the next week with a different presenter. Please, student will present in the next week. Should be prepared in the good manner as suggestion by Ibu Diani. I think it is very important for you speaking something based on your knowledge in history, okay? Not reading. If reading, it is similar with the student in the elementary school, junior high school, senior high school, reading something, Pancasila, one, blah, 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 I think. Please, you explaining something based on pointers, okay. But all text you read, I think it is not good for you. You are a student of history, should understand about the content of history, topic related to the history you choose ourselves, okay? Okay, thank you very much. See you in the next week. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Mr.
Okay, you're welcome.
Thank you, Mr.